neurochemically, the way our brain encodes data, and there's a variety of different books on this, but they all kind of are, you know, they found a normal distribution around this idea of how much we pay attention to things and really focus on them versus how much we just kind of relax and operate on, you know, autopilot. Most of the time we operate on autopilot because it's just more convenient. And this thousands of millions of years of evolution has made that possible. When you start working with landscapes of, that embody trauma for individuals, the landscape now is doing an incredibly powerful job for us, if we let it. By giving the story to the land, you do something very unusual. You take something that is emotive inside of your body and you force it into a very imperfect tool, language. Language is actually kind of really bad at its job as far as, you know, communicating emotions. When your brain is forced to actually convert it into a story, this becomes what you remember the next time you remember it. You don't remember the original trauma.
Welcome to Storytelling Insights, art, science, and great conversations. With storytelling insights from researchers, artists, teachers, and many more.
Okay, well, I'm delighted to welcome Jason Murray Winn on this conversation of the art and science of storytelling. And as you know, I combine mindfulness with storytelling, but there is a big world out there with other storytellers using them in all kinds of ways. So welcome, Jason, and how are you today? And tell us a little bit about your work.
Well, thank you. And the kind of stuff I'm doing is trying to work with the research that, if you know, storytelling is founded on, which is narratology, in order to actually be able to help people to begin to approach everyday situations by acknowledging the story that's actually playing out in front of them, to actually see who the characters are and see how who the chorus is, identify who is acting more like a hero, who is acting more like a victim, and in that way, able to begin to structure, you know, their response in a nuanced way, as opposed to just reacting, just out of habitual pattern, but really stopping, thinking, and going, wait a minute, who's saying this? Why are they saying it? And what is not being said? And how can I bring that forward just so that everyone can acknowledge, one, my own agency in this conversation or the situation, and two, it'll probably help the situation if we catch what's not being said and bring it forward. That's really a powerful, you know, moment for every conversation or for a business situation.
Yeah, no, that's fascinating. And so when you talk about this sense of agency, tell us a bit about, you know, narrative infrastructure and what narrative infrastructure actually does and how it, I suppose, helps. You talk about agency. So I guess, are you using storytelling for really for societal change, or what's the kind of broad thrust for you and how you use a story?
Well, how I use it is, you know, is on very much a case-by-case basis. The methodology is actually based out of some political science and a political science thinker in particular, Hannah Arendt, who was a major writer of the last century. How that can be employed, I teach in a university, I work for an architecture firm and an engineering firm, and I have my own campaigns, my own research I'm doing. So I have a very diverse group of people that I need to be able to connect with, and on very different subjects, using different vocabularies, sometimes in languages that aren't, you know, where English isn't the first language necessarily for the interlocutor and whatnot. And in those situations, I've been developing narrative infrastructure as a kind of a multi-purpose tool. So much so that I actually, you know, I guess back in 2016, I quit my job so that I could actually go back to school. And my reasoning had been, I had been given a project associated with that one firm to develop a project that was going to last 1,000 years. And after 14 months, I had to throw in the towel. I had to give up. I couldn't get them a serious answer.
Right.
I could get them out to about 350 years with a reasonable degree of certainty about, you know, the success of their project or the continuation of their project. But there just became so many unknowns. I was like, I'm spending more time on Google than I was on ASTM standards documents. And I realized this is beyond the state of our art. We don't think like this. We don't think long-term. Of course, here we live in cities and everything, you know, here has been around a lot longer than we have on a pattern basis. And that gnawed at me for a good year and realized, you know what, if no one else is going to do this research, I'm going to have to. I could not let it go. And I didn't know how I was going to approach that kind of a question. How do you genuinely work in the long term? How do you actually, you know, do long-term things? I'd always had an appreciation of storytelling, and I was a member of a storytelling association in San Antonio, Texas. So we were getting up and telling like once a month and listening, and we were even doing critiques, which is awesome. It's really good to have feedback on presentation. And I started talking to a teacher who is a monastic, a Tibetan monk. And I was his cook for the weekend. And so we were sitting over breakfast and I was saying, listen, I've been thinking about doing some, you know, serious research, maybe get a PhD, maybe get a master's. And we went through all my ideas. And when I said storytelling, he said, no, that's it. That's the one. That's what needs to be researched. The world needs to have that done. Wow. And that was easy. And once someone else says, hey, that's what you're going to do, it's like, oh man, okay, well, this is easy. And I like doing it anyway. So, all right. So I guess about 5 months after that, I put in my resignation and gave notice and started applying to universities actually overseas. So I wound up in the Eastern Mediterranean region and finally here in Cyprus. And I did the study on storytelling really from almost kind of thumbing my nose at, you know, the institution that I had just escaped from 15 years of, you know, corporate America. I thought, I know what will really baffle them. I'll tell them I'm going back to school to study storytelling. And it turned out it was just, you know, exactly the right subject. The longest things that are consistently existent in human society is in fact stories. And there was a conference in 2017 on the west coast of Australia, where these researchers actually found they were researching storylines, because the Aboriginal communities of Australia didn't use paper. What they would do is they would record how to navigate across Australia using songs, very long, complicated songs that were literally the characters in the story would actually be the landforms. And these researchers were following, you know, one of these song lines, and all of a sudden it just stopped in the sea. And they're like, oh man, we took a wrong turn. You know, we missed a hill or something, or, you know, a tree was part of the story. And it really turned their brain around for a couple of months, until one of their cohorts, a geologist, said, well, have you considered removing the sea? And so what they did was they artificially lowered, you know, on a computer model, they lowered sea level, and there was the missing landforms.
Where did that juncture, or what happened to get you to that point to tie it to the infrastructure, and how, and tell us a bit more about that as well.
Yeah, I've always got to get around to the good stuff. I think one of the last big projects I did for my architecture and engineering firm was a massive contemporary infrastructure map. So we took all the infrastructure of the city of San Antonio. We took like 30 different offices and convinced them to allow us to compile the data and layer it all together, so we could actually then look down and see how the city was shaped. And also we had their future plans, so we could actually look forward into the future about where they intended to improve power supply, water supply, telecommunications. We had an idea of what the, you know, what the city was going to look like, you know, in 40 years. And so that methodology stuck in my head. It was like, okay, well, you know, we could layer data onto the city. And the real stark realization came to me when I realized that everything around us starts as a story. The entire built world started with one person trying to convince someone else, hey, we should get together and do this. There's nothing that you can point at that didn't first start out as one person trying to convince someone of an idea, telling a story. They were making something up. They lied to each other until they all said, yeah, that would be worth trying. And that's how we get civilization. And what blew my mind was the idea that within a story, it's all this qualitative data, all these feelings and, you know, emotional components. But there's also a very distinct quantitative component. And that's what really clicked in my head. That quantity is when the story happened and the setting, where it happened. I know when and where a story happened, I can map it.
Right.
And if I can then map it, then we can start to ask questions like, what happens if, you know, Ahmet has a story about taking care of his father's business and going to get the ice, you know, and that story was geographically overlaid with a woman from 20 years later talking about preparing her father's coals for his hookah every day before he came back from prayer at the mosque. These people didn't necessarily know each other. They may never have met, but their stories geographically overlapped. And when that started to come forward, it's like, that makes a very strong reason for us to stop and go, if we wanted to understand the sense of a place, then in order for that to be possible, either you need to spend a lot of time there, or you need to read all of their stories. And to read their stories, if you don't know where they are and how they interacted, it's just a list. It's interesting as an ethnographic effort, but it doesn't tell you about the place. And so as an urban designer and an urban planner, always questioning how do we help cities design themselves better, and bridging back off the idea of like, well, everything is a story. And the strongest and longest piece of human technology is storytelling. Why can't we bring those ideas together? And that's how it started, you know, the idea of don't archive stories in a filing cabinet. Don't archive stories in a book. What if they're in the different language? You can't keyword search an internet archive if you don't know the keyword.
Yeah.
But what if what's important is not what, but where? And then you would actually, that's why libraries are so cool. You walk into a library and there's a whole section of books that you didn't even necessarily know that it had these neighbors. And that's why you spend the whole afternoon sitting in that particular stack in the library, is because that there was all these other references that never popped up on your keyword search, but their association by the Dewey Decimal System puts them side by side. That's what the story is really awesome for, is that we can actually put stories geographically that are related by space, and then allow those to spontaneously come forward. As soon as someone wants to know about a particular intersection or a particular building, they can see the milieu of competing memories, the sense of ownership of all those people. So if you're going to make a decision for making a change to the city right there, like say you're going to do a development, you're going to start a business, wouldn't it be the utmost and powerful, you know, power move to modify your business plan so that it actually reflects a continuity of the stories that are already there, that you're simply writing the next chapter in the stories that literally exist? They're not boosterism. They're not a great idea from the far side of the planet or the other side of the country or even the other side of town. Now your idea is literally birthed from the narrative around you. from the community stories. Now, when you come forward as a business, you know, entrepreneur, and you say, I have this great idea, and everyone looks at it and sees that it's essentially their own memories brought into a new idea, they're like, oh yeah, okay, sure.
So there is something here where there is not only a kind of really emotive component when it comes to urban planning and town planning and things like this. And I've got a good friend who's really into urban planning, and he spends a lot of time looking at smart cities and how the streets and everything they almost replicate, or they do replicate nature. If you zoom into a leaf, for example, and we'd see all these patterns replicating. So we are building out from what we've had in the past based on a collective of narratives. And this is not only going to help with the selling, but this, I guess what you're saying is it helps to give more meaning to people, to these new areas that might be constructed, or, you know, what's the kind of real juice for, let's say, me in my town? I don't know if some other part of this, the area was rebuilt or developed. So I'm now persuaded, because I know, you actually just got me thinking as well, actually, Jason, about, was it Google, or there was some technology company, I think it's Google, where there was this, you could actually look at history through your smartphone at certain parts. So you could almost put your phone up in a town and then watch the actual footage of a horse and cart going by and things like that. So that's quite emotive for people. I guess that brings to life, like, wow, sitting right here where I am at this moment, you know, Phil Collins' great granddad who lived down the road from where my son used to play football actually just walked by. And how does that then create more meaning or influence the next phase of development? What's the kind of real sort of juicy part there?
So you can imagine that kind of, you know, technology in 100 years is going to be normal, right? I mean, you'll just have geolocated artwork and geolocated history all on a virtual, you know, basis. And some of my favorite authors, science fiction authors, have been saying this for 30 years. William Gibson, you know, he came up with this idea a long time ago. The most important component that I want, you know, people to take advantage of is that when you actually borrow from the past very consciously, like you actually look at it, you work with it, and then say, what's the next logical chapter? What you're doing is the kind of development that cities do when no one's looking. And that kind of result is what creates the picturesque town. These little incremental changes that are a logical next step, as opposed to these grand redesigns, you know, which completely re-envision a city and initially displace thousands of people, you know, for urban renewal and so on and so forth, and is really more kind of a monument to, you know, one or two person's egos. And yeah, we now have to study these very annoying people because they managed to accumulate power that allowed them to actually affect a change. But then why does the tourist industry find itself catering to small villages? Why is there such a draw to that classic environment, that spontaneously evolved environment? And the stupid simple answer is the meaningfulness of it. And it's very useful to use, you know, the words the way they were meant to be used. So when something means something, it is standing in to represent something else. And that's it. It doesn't have any other connotations unless you give it there. And so if something is meaningful, it's because it represents other things. Something that is full of meaning represents a lot. It allows your mind to actually organize more things. And that's a meaningful environment. A meaningful piece of art is that it brings more of your own mind and your own experience into focus. and gives you a frame of reference that is meaningful.
That's
when you look at an old city, right? It's making the connotation into the past and demonstrating it. And it's not demonstrating it in a Walt Disney kind of way. It's actually, you know, decaying in front of you. You can see 50 years of patina. That suggests a continuity. And this is where it all comes around to particularly mindfulness, is that it reminds you that there is more than just your day-to-day struggle. That's what meaning gives you, is that it takes you. That's why religion deals very heavily in meaning, because they want to grant that. They know there's a market for it. People want to feel that there's something meaningful. And that meaning just is a frame of reference that gives you a way to see your role in that larger picture. Wow. Nothing simpler than that.
Yeah, that's a yeah. Lots of stimulus here. So in other words, then, so I guess in one aspect, I mean, there will be some romantic notions in terms of historical experience in a particular geographical location. And I guess there would probably be some challenging experiences as well. For example, I mean, imagine it was, I don't know, in a town that had some sort of atrocity, or some other stories would have been going on there. You can still, in some ways, take that story and evolve it. I assume that's also part of the benefit of the story and the narrative infrastructure and planning to create more meaning. I mean, I imagine, like, after 9/11, for example, when it was, the question was asked, you know, what are we going to put here? Would you see this as a great way of even overcoming those kinds of challenges, or evolving from, should I say, those kinds of sort of planning challenges?
It goes in a different direction, and it's a very important direction. And it comes down to the neurochemistry. Neurochemically, the way our brain encodes data, and there's a variety of different books on this, but they all kind of are, you know, they found a normal distribution around this idea of how much we pay attention to things and really focus on them versus how much we just kind of relax and operate on, you know, autopilot. Most of the time we operate on autopilot because it's just more convenient. And This thousands of millions of years of evolution has made that possible. When you start working with landscapes that embody trauma for individuals, the landscape now is doing an incredibly powerful job for us, if we let it. By giving the story to the land, you do something very unusual. You take something that is emotive inside of your body and you force it into a very imperfect tool, language. Language is actually kind of really bad at its job as far as, you know, communicating emotions. When your brain is forced to actually convert it into a story, this becomes what you remember the next time you remember it. You don't remember the original trauma. Emergency medical technicians use this technique now. As soon as they encounter someone who's just gone through a car wreck or just gone through a very violent situation, the first thing they do is ask them, tell me what happened. Tell me precisely what happened.
Yeah.
And the person's still in shock. They, you know, so they're actually quite suggestible because they are, you know, emotionally in a very difficult situation. And biologically, they can now tell a story. And they are quite literally being asked to give over the emotional content of their trauma into the language, which doesn't do it justice by a long stretch. Mm-hmm. And then the next time they remember what happened, they will will remember the story they told as opposed to the actual trauma in their body.
That, I guess, that partly also explains, from a sort of neuroscientific point of view or physiological point of view, why the stories also change. And not necessarily change because we're consciously changing them, but they change because maybe the patterns of memory are changing, or they're being compounded by new experiences and all this kind of stuff.
Right.
So when you say give it to the land, what do you mean by giving the story to the land?
When you have something like a genuine atrocity, like an entire village being wiped out, something along those kinds of lines, or most of a village. Not much point in worrying about an entire village because there's no one there to remember. But when you're working with survivors, and that's the important point, you've had a tornado come through, you've had a tsunami come through, massive fires, flooding in Germany, et cetera, flooding in China, much worse. The landscape, when you actually pinpoint where things happened after the fact, and I'll give you another interesting point for before that, but if you pinpoint where that traumatic story happened after it has happened, you literally assign all those words and all that meaning to the space, and you very consciously recognize it in the physical environment. The physical environment is inherently impermanent. At its core, it's impermanent. And so while you may still have trauma, you may still be dealing with trauma, now that you've assigned it to something that is evolving, evolving slowly and naturally and developing other meanings at the same time, the trauma itself dissipates. Not immediately. It's not like a magic pill. Wow. But if you don't give it to the land and you carry it around like a pariah on your back, you know, and you are, you know, a refugee for life.
Yeah.
Then that is your identity. You know, you're literally coining your trauma and spending it in order to support yourself. That is not useful to you as far as recovery goes. When we work with migrant issues, and we have direct migrant issues here in Cyprus, we're at the front line of the migrant issues, dealing with the fallout of Arab Spring. One of the biggest things that we talk about at, you know, University of Nicosia is how can we work with the memories of where they're coming from? And one of the most important things is not just to go through the traumatic ones, even though that is the therapeutic mode.
Yeah.
But one of the most powerful things that gets really exciting is when you actually, if you have your narrative infrastructure established before a disaster, so you've recorded your stories, maybe you didn't actually go to the effort of mapping them before, but a story contains setting and it usually has a date at the top. So even if it's in a textual format, we can convert it into a mapped format. That means that after everything has been wiped away and there's been the decimation of the environment, the memories are locatable. And that doesn't necessarily mean that you would build back identically, but you would build back as inspired by the stories that came before so that continuity can be reestablished.
Wow. That's quite incredible. And actually, it's so fascinating too, because the kind of things that I'm thinking about as I hear this is, so this narrative infrastructure has a lot of power for, I get this bridging the gap, the continuity piece, and that's really strong. Now I'm hearing there's a kind of an element of almost therapeutic, even though you're not doing it in the sort of traditional, you know, psychotherapy narrative way. But also it's not then bound by, you're not relying on, let's say, the example of the Aborigines, and you know, in this narrative infrastructure, an entire new population of people can come and recreate a lot of the magic that was there in the meaning that was there beforehand without having the exact same people there. So, because I'm just thinking about how the world is changing so much, and you're talking about refugees in Cyprus and flows of populations have always happened, you know, for time immemorial, but they're happening even more and more, and greater flows of ethnicities and so on. So there is a way to keep the essence in the narrative infrastructure approach with a lot of, I guess, do you see where I'm going with this? This kind of historical, cultural, ethnic relationship with the land and the infrastructure can be carried through even without the same ethnicities being around. Is that a kind of potential reality out of that?
There's research to be done on the necessity or efficacy of utilizing memories of that are technically of people who are no longer living. To a certain degree, that is romanticism,
right? Yeah.
In the strictest sense. Mm. The use of living memory, the use of memory that is being currently passed down or is at least harbored in the minds of the locals, the use of that is A, respectful, obviously. And it also builds a community up rather than tries to fix it.
Yeah.
That's the big thing, is that everyone wants to see, you know, foreign aid flying around the world, going into environments and not actually, you know, reinvesting in the magic that is self-existent and been evolving in that location for how many thousands of years. And instead saying, what you really need is Starbucks and McDonald's. You need tourism. They're like, this is a holy site. No, we don't want tourism. that's the challenge, is that our, you know, the political bodies, you know, want to do good. They want to garner votes. They want to, you know, get international goodwill, but their focus is much more on the power angle. So, and I mean that very succinctly, in action. They're trying to express agency. And that doesn't necessarily become meaningful until after the fact. Hannah Arendt goes into this in depth, and she says, when you're actually in the action of a story, you don't know what the result's going to be. You can't know. You have to trust that you're doing the right thing based off of your own identity, but the actual results of what's going to happen will be judged by others. The actual meaning of the story of which you are a member of will be judged after. Storytelling happens after the hero has finished their quest, always. But when we talk about, you know, specifically working with the land, that's a fantastic interaction I had with a Hoja. He was a imam back in San Antonio. And Abdulrahim Muhammad, he looked at me and he said very simply, says, if you're looking for common ground, look at your feet. And I was like, oh, man, he just blew like half of the self-help section out the door. And I was like, man, that is, and because you have to be somewhere to be to be a human being. The internet and, you know, the online social environment has got to be seen from that angle, that it is a social environment. It's not your community. Your community is the people which you actually commune with, that you actually are physically nearby. It's part of the human condition. You have to physically be somewhere on this planet, with the rare exception of a couple of billionaires. You have to physically be on this planet somewhere. Wherever you are, no one else can actually physically be, because that's where you're taking up space. And that's where all the conflicts usually arise, is people fighting over that space, trying to get you not to take up that space. So when we start seeing about how you know, we address living memory, that is why we do this, is because people do need to be somewhere. Every migrant, every refugee, every expatriate physically needs to be somewhere. That's non-negotiable. You know, you can't just keep putting them on planes and, you know, finding a new place to stash people. We're not got our lunar base set up. We haven't gotten to that. Thank goodness we're not, you know, exporting people. You know, those days are gone for now. That, you know, in therein says, if that's the fact that everyone has to be somewhere, everyone's going to have a story. And if you're not being inclusive for your immediate physical environment, of those people who share that immediately physical environment, you're not really relating to your actual community. You're trying to import ideas. You're trying to, you know, change the situation to, you know, to take advantage of think of it like a garden that's been naturally evolving, and you're trying to come in and pluck all the apples. It's like, well, I mean, that happens. That does happen. Is that respectful? No, that's not respectful. And that doesn't lead to a community garden where we all work together to actually, you know, layer those stories together. And some of those stories will be distasteful. You know, yeah, morals yeah. change. The fact is, if you got someone who's living that memory, And goodness knows, we have huge swaths of where I'm from the United States, where people are living the memory of, you know, racial inequality and loving it. My own family members are just like, oh, you know, it's a new millennium, you know.
So actually, one of the things you got me thinking about as I'm listening to is, how does the collective juice get squeezed out of those stories to inform the infrastructure as it evolves as well? Is there kind of like a thematic approach where you start to pull out, you know, well, you know, I get the gist of this particular area is about togetherness. This particular area is where the mothers shared their love with the children. And, you know, I'm just making this up, but is that the kind of approach you would use to pull out the themes to help the evolution of the infrastructure?
Yes. The short answer is absolutely. The work there is when it starts to turn into ethnography and you start to bring a code set to the stories. So say you have 20 stories and you start there. The classical ethnography is to develop your codes a posteriori. So that means after you've read them, then you actually see your notes and you see what are the themes that developed. And then you can build a local ethnography. And it's a graph of the ethnography. And then you can start to say, okay, these are our codes. How are they distributed on the land? Where are their blank spots? Where are their conflict locations? You know, what can we do in order to say, here's one set of stories with a particular theme of, let's say, work, and another set of stories that have a conflicting theme of labor, and that the people that are working 9 to 5 can't wrap their brains around these laborers who are out there at 5 in the morning starting to dig holes. Right. So you have this, you have an overlap in a particular part of the city that there's a conflict that arises. You can only find that by mapping them. There's no other way to find it. It's all just hearsay if you don't actually map them. Maps do that service for us. They become the common map. And the codes that you choose as an ethnographer can be a posteriori. As a city planner, I take the liberty of using a priori codes that I pull from other locations that are based on psychology, largely. Mm-hmm. A lot of my work is coming out of The Human Condition by Hannah Arendt, who put forward, as I said, particularly labor, work, and action are her fundamental, she made that the core thesis of her book, The Human Condition.
Yeah.
And I saw that there was 3 other subcodes that went with that. And that really allowed me to see the city in a whole new light. Once you actually see that the limitations of what humans bother to deal with throughout their lives, all the spice and nuance and the songs and the weddings, that aside, there are some things that are actually more or less common across cultures. They are not tall buildings. They are not necessarily food or where you eat food or how you eat food, but you do eat food. And you do it somewhere, you do it somehow. So that's your sense of enjoyment, your sense of labor, and where that actually manifests. It's going to be a response that's going to have to be local, but at the same time, you're going to find a common set of themes if you're backed out that far. If you're doing ethnography work and you're trying to relate to a particular community, you would come in and you would do a posteriori codes and you would actually pull them from their own narratives. Yeah. But that's because that's the goal, you know, is to actually map the community, to map their ethnicity. If your goal is to try and see how these ethnicities are mixing in a multicultural city, you need to use a higher level set of codes in order to begin to see how we can find some commonalities, maybe. You know, I mean, if you have one community that does not dance and another community that does nothing but dance, where those two communities come together, you need to find something that bridges those two stories without actually upsetting either side, that you come up. And the whole point of that is actually very simple. It's simply saying that if you allow the line to be solid, then they're not actually a community. They've built a wall. Might just be a wall of activity that their domains abut, but they're going to overlap. And somebody's daughter is going to wind up dating somebody's son. Stuff happens. And if you're not going to relate to it, then it's going to be conflict. But if you could, you know, relate to the fact that there is a borderland where, you know, an ethnic, you know, community, you know, is going to have a friendly zone with its neighboring ethnic community. With this tool, we can actually say physically where to spend that money.
Well, I guess there's one last question then, if I may. What do you sort of feel the future? I know storytelling is a big word, which is why we're kind of exploring these things, and it's all, you know, used in all kinds of different ways. Do you see any kind of limitations or to storytelling just generally, or do you see it needs to evolve in any particular way? Maybe would you like to see more of a particular use for stories, or less even on the other side of a particular way stories are being used a lot now?
I think for me, the real awareness has come that nothing happens that isn't a story. Nothing at all. Narrative infrastructure is a fancy term I came up with for a system that has been existent for thousands of years. It's how everything is operated. It just wasn't recorded in any useful way. You just had to live it. You had to know it. You had to know what that you were going to upset somebody's uncle if you built your fence there. You had to know that. And now with the massive movement of capital and whatnot, it's become more important that we have a way to envision the local story. It's there, it's unavoidable. And if you're acting in the business component or in the policy arena, and you're ignorant of the local stories, you cannot help but cause friction.
Yeah.
Those stories are there. That's what those people believe. That's what's meaningful to them. If what you're saying isn't meaningful to them, you're wrong, no matter how good your idea is. Yeah. Scientists struggle with this. And for them, it's all proof. It's, you know, if it's proof, it'll work. But if you can't explain it, Alan Alda, he's been making a big deal about this with his podcast. If you cannot explain in terms people understand what your science is, they're going to reject it because they didn't ever hear it before. It's not part of the shape of their world. You have to find that part of the shape of their world and then bring your new idea in, like a bridge builder coming at, you know, to the middle. You have to start with what you're coming from, but if you don't know where you're going with that bridge, you don't have a prayer of actually communicating effectively, moving your agenda, and getting agency to go forward. And if you talk about the only limitations of stories, the simple truth is that if you're engaged in political action, then you're not storytelling. You're a part of a story and you don't know what's going to happen. That's the limitation.
Oh, before you go, I just want to say thank you for tuning in. Please subscribe to my channel. It means a lot more than you know. And I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Bye for now.